Well, amen. Thank you so much, choir and orchestra. We appreciate that. I invite you to open your Bibles today to the book of Ecclesiastes. Find chapter number 5, please. Ecclesiastes chapter number 5, and we're going to look at the Old Testament today. And I really hope that if you were not able to be here last Sunday, that you have been able to listen to the sermon from last Sunday, because last Sunday's sermon is going to kind of set the stage for where I feel impressed by God to go with our church over the next 6 to 8 weeks in a couple of small series of sermons. But today we're going to be in Ecclesiastes chapter number 5. And really, the theme of last Sunday, we talked about being passionate about our personal spiritual growth in 2021. And that really is the prayer of my life. I want to grow more in my relationship with Christ this year than I have ever grown since I have been a believer. And I pray that you will have that same desire and that same passion as well. But what I want to do over these next 6 to 8 weeks is I want to look at two very brief sermon series that deal with two areas of life that I really think have the potential to greatly hinder our spiritual growth. One of those is the area of money, and the second is the area of marriage. Now, normally what we do is we take these two things and we put them in the category of the secular. But when we read the Bible, we see that the Bible takes these two areas of money and marriage and places them in the area of the spiritual. As a matter of fact, God has so much to say about these two areas of our lives, and especially when we are believers and followers of Christ. So today, the title of the series is God, Money, and Me. And today I want to talk about the limitations of money. Now, don't misunderstand this focus on money that we're going to have over the next few weeks, because the whole purpose of this sermon series is not to raise money. In fact, when you look at our church during 2020, in spite of all that happened, in spite of the fact that attendance was reduced by about 50%, we ended 2020 stronger than we did 2019. Because of the faithfulness of God's people in the giving of money. So my purpose is not in this series to raise money. My purpose is to raise our faith. And you see, if we are not rightly related when it comes to money, to what the Word of God says about it and our stewardship responsibilities, then we're going to be greatly hindered in our spiritual growth. As a matter of fact, this is one of the key things that the Bible addresses over and over and over again when it comes to God's people. So, you know, I'm not trying to strong arm you into tithing, because the truth of the matter is you don't really need to tithe to support the church. You need to tithe to make sure that you support your spiritual growth. Because if you're not rightly related to this idea of money, it can greatly hinder your growth, or it can extend your growth if you are doing what God says to do. But today, I want to talk about the limitations of money. And really, my whole emphasis is to try to convince us today to be on guard against developing a love affair with money. You know, just as a love affair can absolutely destroy your marriage and your family and your relationship with your spouse, a love affair with money can destroy and devastate our relationship with God. So let's see what the writer of Ecclesiastes, who was King Solomon, had to say about this whole idea of money, and see how it has such limitations. In the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 5, beginning with verse 10, Solomon says, "He who loves silver will not be satisfied with silver, nor he who loves abundance with increase. This is also vanity. When goods increase, they increase who eat them. So what profit have the owners except to see them with their eyes? The sleep of a laboring man is sweet. whether he eats little or much. But the abundance of the rich will not permit him to sleep. There is a severe evil which I have seen under the sun. Riches kept for their owner to his hurt, but those riches to perish through misfortune when he begets a son. There is nothing in his hand. As he came down from his mother's womb, naked shall he return to go as he came. And he shall take nothing from his labor, which he may carry away in his hand. And this also is a severe evil. Just exactly as he came, so shall he go. And what profit has he who has labored for the wind? All his days he also eats in darkness, and he has much sorrow and sickness and anger. Now, some assume that when you begin talking about money, that immediately you stop talking about spiritual things, that you're to separate those two things. But I want to show you something interesting. Back up to chapter 5 and verse number 1 of Ecclesiastes. And here King Solomon is preparing God's people to go into the temple to worship. And he says, now, as you're going in to worship, that there are some things that you ought to consider, because worship will not occur if you don't focus on these things. Verse 1 of chapter 5, he said, walk prudently when you go to the house of God. Draw near to hear rather than to give the sacrifice of fools, for they do not know that they do evil. So the first thing that he mentions here is pay attention to your heart. Make sure that your heart's in it. You're not just showing up, you know, you're not just playing the part and playing the role, but your heart's in it. Then down in verses 2 and 3, he talks about paying attention to your words if you want to have a worship experience. Do not be rash with your mouth. Let not your heart utter anything hastily before God, for God is in heaven and you on the earth. Therefore, let your words be few, for a dream comes through much activity, and a fool's voice is known by his many words. Do you want to worship God, he says? Pay attention to your heart. You want to worship God? Pay attention to your words. Then he says, if you want to worship God, pay close attention to your verbal commitments. Verses 4 and 5, when you make a vow to God, do not delay to pay it. Anybody made one of those lately? God, if you'll get me out of this, I promise you. When you make a vow to God, do not delay to pay it, for he has no pleasure in fools. Pay what you have vowed. Better not to vow than to vow and not to pay. And then he talks about the importance of paying attention to the less fortunate. Verses 8 and 9, if you see the oppression of the poor and the violent, perversion of justice and righteousness in a province, do not marvel at that matter, for a high official watches over high official, and higher officials are over them. Moreover, the profit of the land is for all, even the king is served from the field. And then, of all things, when he's focusing on worship, he begins in verse 10 talking about money. You see, don't assume that when you start talking about money that you're leaving behind the spiritual, because that is just not the case. And I say that it's a very dangerous thing to develop a love affair with money, because the Bible says that the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Money's not evil. Money is neutral. But the love of money will produce all kinds of evil actions. So to say that when we talk about money, we've moved out of the realm of the spiritual is simply a false statement. As a matter of fact, the very best heart monitor there could be to gauge our spiritual condition is our attitude toward money. Just like when you hook up an EKG to someone's heart, it reveals what the physical condition of the heart is. I think that our attitude toward money, what we do with it, how we handle it, how we view it, what is our perspective of it, will tell us a whole lot about our spiritual condition. Let me give you some Bible facts. Did you know that one out of every six verses in Matthew, Mark, and Luke speak about money? One out of every six verses, out of the 38 parables in the New Testament, half of them Jesus devoted to discussing money. 15% of everything Jesus said that is recorded in Scripture has to do with attitudes and actions regarding money. So if we never talk about money in the Christian life, we are neglecting 15% of everything that our Savior said. Did you know that there are 2,350 verses in the Bible that address the subject of money, while there are only 275 verses that talk about prayer and 350 verses that talk about faith? Friends, when you compare that with the 2,350 that talk about money, that tells me that money is something that is an important issue to God. And it relates to our spiritual growth. And if we don't get the right handle on that, we are not going to grow and mature spiritually in 2021. But why is it that you and I should not have a love affair with money? It is because of its limitations. There are so many things money can't do. And that is what is being pointed out in Ecclesiastes chapter 5. Down in verse 10 and verse number 16, he says that money does not bring satisfaction in life. He who loves silver will not be satisfied with silver. Verse 16, and also this is a severe evil. Just exactly as he came, he shall also go. What profit has he who has labored for the wind? The wind is something that is, you just can't get a hold of. It is intangible. So what profit is there for the person that has lived their entire life for the accumulation of money? It just does not bring satisfaction. And the person who lives their life for the getting of things and the things that money can buy and the accumulation of wealth, they end up living in the Mick Jagger syndrome. You know, Mick Jagger was the lead singer of the Rolling Stones. I saw them back in the day when I was stationed in Colorado. And he was made famous for that song, what? I Can't Get No Satisfaction. And there was an entire generation that was the cry of their heart. And they tried to get satisfaction from everything, from experiencing with marijuana to methamphetamines to sex to Eastern mystery religions, but at the end of the day, they did not find any satisfaction. And friend, I just want to simply say that to build one's life around nothing but financial goals and to use the metric of measuring success in life by nothing but outward gains is to end a life where you will find absolutely no satisfaction. Now, please understand me this morning. There's not a sin in having money. It is not a sin to have money. But friend, it is a sin when money has us. And there are few people that can have money without money having them. But why is it that we really ought to listen to King Solomon and his advice? Well, the Bible says he's the wisest man who ever lived, but he was also the wealthiest man who ever lived. As a matter of fact, I think that we could make a point, a strong point. We know that he was the most wealthy guy of his day, but we could also make a point that he's the most wealthy man who has ever lived. I was reading in preparation for this sermon over in 1 Kings, and I was reading about the life of King Solomon, and I was reading about that encounter that he had with the Queen of Sheba. Remember that story? And she had heard all of the press releases about Solomon and all of his wisdom and prosperity, and so she went to pay him a visit. And in this text, 1 Kings chapter 10, it tells us a little bit about Solomon's wealth. It says, now when the queen of Sheba heard the fame of Solomon concerning the name of the Lord, she came to test him with hard questions. She came to Jerusalem with a very great retinue, with camels and that bore spices, very much gold, precious stones. When she came to Solomon, she spoke with him about all that was in her heart. And so Solomon answered all of her questions. There was nothing difficult, too difficult for the king, that he could not explain it to her. And when the queen of Sheba, when she had seen the wisdom of his house that he had built, when she saw the food that was on his table, the seating of his servants, the service of the waiters and their apparel, his cupbearers and his entryway by which he went into the house of the Lord, there was no more spirit in her. And then she said to the king, "It was a true report which I heard in my own land about your words and about your wisdom. However, I did not believe the words until I came and I saw with my own eyes, and indeed the half was not told me. Your wisdom and prosperity exceed the fame of which I heard. Happy are your men and happy are your servants who stand continually before you and hear your wisdom. Blessed be the Lord your God who delighted in you, setting you on the throne of Israel, because the Lord has so loved Israel forever. Therefore he made you the king to do justice and righteousness." And then she gave the king over 120 talents of gold. That's $3.5 million. Who says the rich don't get richer? And then down in verse number 14, the weight of gold that came to Solomon yearly was 666 talents of gold, $25 million annually. That's the salary that he made. And yet he was singing the Mick Jagger blues. "I can't get no satisfaction." After all that he had, as wealthy as he was, it still did not bring satisfaction in his life. Friend, why is it that money cannot bring satisfaction? Why is it? It's because of one very important thing that Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 6, verse 19. Jesus said, "Lay not up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust can destroy and thieves can break through and steal." That is why it cannot bring satisfaction. Why is that? It's because money and what money can buy, number one, it depreciates. It depreciates. It does not last. The 2009 Dodge truck that I drive, it is not worth today what it was when it was purchased. Why is that? Because it depreciates. You see, dear friend, that which will not last can never bring satisfaction to the only thing that will last, and that is the eternal soul of man. That's the only thing that's going to last. And so when we are looking for satisfaction, we ought to look for satisfaction in those things, listen, that have eternity attached to them. Because that's the only thing that can bring satisfaction in life. It depreciates. Number two, it demands. In our text in verse number 11, when goods increase, they increase who eat them. Any of you ever witnessed that? The more you make, the more that are there that want part of what you make. And the individual who simply lives to get and to get and to get, then lives their life to guard what they have gotten. And they live their lives simply worrying. Friend, I'm saying that when our passion is for more money, our passion will never be satisfied, because our yearning power will always be less than our earning power. We will never be able to earn what we yearn for. Let me tell you something, another reason why money is such a dangerous thing. It demands time and allegiance that we really ought to be giving to God. And when it becomes the passion of our life, we begin treating money like it is a god. We love it. We sacrifice for it. Sacrifice time that we should be giving to God. Sacrifice time that we should be giving to our families. Sacrifice our health to try to get more and more and more and more and more. Listen, it's thoughts just occupy and fill our minds. Someone said one time, "Well, money may not be the number one thing, but it is way beyond what is number two." That's not true. If you're a Christian, friend, I'll tell you what's number one in your life: God. What's number two in your life is your family. And so money is way down on the priority list. It cannot be the number one thing. It demands, but it also desensitizes. It desensitizes. Now, friend, let me just stop and say right here, I know a lot of wealthy people who at the same time are very generous people. I know a lot of wealthy people who invest in the kingdom of God, who give of their money to build the kingdom of God, who are always looking for people who are less fortunate, someone that they can help. I have had people come to me time and time again over the years with great wealth who would say, you know, I see that here is a need over here. I want you to give this money to them, and I don't want to be identified as the one who gave it. There are a lot of wealthy people like that. But the point that's being made here is that the person who has money, they have to be extremely careful because it can desensitize them to the needs of those around them because they can't identify with those needs. They don't have those needs. They don't know what it's like to do without. They don't know what it's like to struggle to pay a bill. And he's saying that if you got money, man, be careful because you can become desensitized to the needs of those around you. And as the Bible says, it's God who gives you the power to get the wealth, and God gives us wealth for the purpose of investing in the kingdom and helping others. That's why God gives us our wealth in the first place. But he says the person who is wealthy, they have to be extremely careful of this. You know, I think that there is such a strong word of warning in verses 8 and 9. Because really what Solomon is pointing out here is politicians who have become corrupt. They have become corrupt because of their power. And they were abusing others. Man, if that is not a word for our day, and I could chase a rabbit right here. But I mean, explain to me how it is that someone can go into Congress or the Senate on a salary that's not a huge salary, can stay there for 40 or 50 years and come out a multi-millionaire. How did they get that? Only one answer. Not popular, but it's corruption. You see, money is power. And power corrupts. And that's the word of warning here. If you got money, be careful. Because you're holding something in your hand that's powerful. But listen, if you don't surrender that thing to God, then it can ultimately corrupt you. I think a great illustration of that and the danger of wealth is found in Luke chapter 16 when Jesus tells a story about a rich man and a poor man. There was a poor man that was laying at the gate of the rich man, and he was there simply because he wanted some crumbs that were falling off the table of the rich man. The rich man came outside, went to work every day or did whatever he did, and he never even noticed the guy. He had become so desensitized to the guy that he just let him lie there. And then the story goes on and says that the rich man died and went to hell. Now, he didn't die and go to hell because he was rich. He died and he went to hell because he had become desensitized. Number one, his wealth, his riches had blinded him to the fact that he needed God. I've got all of this, so I don't need God in my life. Oh, yes, you do need God in your life. And he became desensitized. What a strong word of warning that is. And then secondly, it says that money not only cannot satisfy, but it does not bring sleep. Money does not bring sleep. That's one of the limitations. Down in verse number 12, the sleep of a laboring man is sweet, whether he eats little or much, but the abundance of the rich will not permit him to sleep. That's another way of saying money really can't bring peace. It can't bring rest. Joe Louis, the heavyweight boxer, used to say, I really don't like money actually, but it just calms my nerves. Well, the guy who had everything in life, he would not agree with that. Solomon. Solomon was saying that not only can wealth not guarantee you a good night's rest, but that cannot guarantee you that it's going to calm your nerves. I think more than one pastor has used John D. Rockefeller as an illustration of how wealth can ruin a person's life. John D. Rockefeller, at the age of 53, was the only billionaire in the world. And it was estimated back then that he made $1 million a week. Extremely wealthy. And yet he was also very sick. He had such serious stomach problems because of worry that his diet consisted of nothing but milk and crackers. That's all he could eat, milk and crackers. Had billions, but could not enjoy eating a meal. But then something changed. Rockefeller began to help others out of his abundance. And he enjoyed celebrating his 98th birthday. See, the warning is wealth has the power to corrupt a person's life. Friend, there is nothing wrong with having the things that money can buy, as long as you do not lose the things that money cannot buy. I want to tell you the key to a good night's rest. The key to a good night's rest is found in one word. It's the word contentment. Contentment. And the person who is not content with little will never be content with much. And contentment comes how? Where do we get it? We get it from counting our blessings from God rather than counting our cash. Money does not bring satisfaction. Money does not bring sleep. Money does not bring significance. There are so many people in life who think, well, if I could just enlarge my portfolio, and if I could just get more money and make more and have more, then it would boost my own self-esteem. And it would also boost my significance in the eyes of others. Others would look at me in a different way, and I would be more significant. And friend, let me tell you, that is a real need of man. I believe God has created us with the desire and the need in our hearts for significance. We need to feel like we're making a valuable contribution in life, don't we? I live for one thing, and if I didn't know that I was accomplishing this, I don't know what I would do. I live for the purpose of knowing that I am having a spiritual influence in the lives of others. Pastor, when will you stop preaching? It is when I am convinced that no longer do I have the ability, as led by the Spirit of God, to make a spiritual impact in the lives of others. I live for that. I need that significant feeling. And everybody else needs that as well. But friend, I want to tell you, that does not come from money. It does not come from having wealth. What did the guy say who had it all? Ecclesiastes chapter 2, verse 11. He said, "Then I looked on all the works that my hands had done, on all the labor in which I had toiled. And indeed, it was all vanity. I was just grasping for the wind, and there was no profit under the sun. I had all of this. I worked hard. I built up my kingdom. And at the end of the trip, it was all emptiness." Friend, wealth cannot bring us a feeling of significance. A wise old man one day looked at a very young man, and he said, "What are you going to do with your life?" The young man said, "Well, I'm going to go to college, get a business degree." "Well, what then?" "Well, I'm going to move to New York, and I'm going to get a job on Wall Street." "Well, what then?" "Well, I'm going to make a lot of money. I'm going to become a millionaire." "What then?" "Well, I'm going to build me a fine house. From all the money I make, I'm going to be able to retire early and enjoy life." The old man said, "What then?" He said, "Well, I guess I'm going to retire, and I'm going to enjoy my kids and my grandkids and just chill out and relax and live the dream. And he said, well, what then? He said, well, I guess I'm going to die. And the old man said, well, what then? What then? The person who lives their life to accumulate wealth, thinking that will bring them significance in life, that will never come to fruition unless that person has a plan for eternity. What's your plan for eternity? Friend, listen, if you don't have a plan for eternity, it doesn't matter what your plan is right now. And then he says finally that wealth, I'll tell you why it's limited, because it does not bring security. It doesn't bring security. Verses 13 through 17 of our text, there's a severe evil which I have seen under the sun, riches kept for the owner to his hurt. But those riches perish through misfortune. When he begets a son, there's nothing in his hand. As he came from his mother's womb, naked shall he return to go as he came. And he shall take nothing from his labor, which he may carry away in his hand. And this is also a severe evil, just exactly as he came, so shall he go. What profit has he who has labored for the wind? Solomon really tells two stories here of two rich men. One of them, he said, just hoarded everything that he had and became a miser and was miserable. The other made some unsound investments and lost it all. And then he had nothing to leave to his son. And he lived the rest of his days in discouragement, defeat, in depression, and in darkness. He says, listen, riches can't bring security because they do not last. Friend, listen, I've really come this morning with a burden on my heart just to simply tell you two things. Number one, don't have a love affair with money. And number two, don't be deceived by its false promises. Money promises things on which it cannot deliver. Money cannot bring security. Why? It is unstable. Over in the book of Proverbs, this same author tells us something interesting about money to show how unstable that it really is. Will you set your eyes on that which is not? For riches certainly make themselves like wings. They fly away like an eagle toward heaven. Time's not the only thing that flies. Money does too. It's unstable. And it's also temporary. It's temporary. The writer says in Ecclesiastes 5, verse 15, as he came from his mother's womb, naked shall he return to go as he came. And he shall take nothing that is from this life, from his labor, that he may carry away in his hand. Nothing brings security that does not last. Money is temporary. An old Jewish proverb says, there are no pockets in shrouds. When you wrap that dead body in the shroud and put it in the coffin, aren't any pockets there. Don't take it with you. It's kind of like we would say, there are no U-Haul trailers behind hearses. You don't take it with you. You know, I think we've learned something important today. We have learned that money cannot bring satisfaction, cannot bring sleep, cannot bring significance, and it cannot bring security. Well, Pastor, what can bring satisfaction? What can bring sleep? What can bring significance? What can bring security? Answer, in the Word of God. Ecclesiastes 3, verse 11, He has made everything beautiful in its time. He has put eternity in our hearts. What is the only thing that can bring these things we've just seen that money can't? What's the only thing? God. A relationship with God. We were created by God in the image of God for God. Our chief aim in life is to enjoy God forever and to bring Him glory. That's the only thing that can bring what we are looking for in life. How many of you like the game of Monopoly? You know, I used to play it all the time when my kids were small. Karen and I would gather around with our kids and we'd play Monopoly. I haven't played it for years, but probably would if I was given another opportunity. But when I played the game of Monopoly, I played to win. Didn't matter that my kids were small. I wanted to win the game. Why play if you're not going to win? And so I was focused. You know, and there were two pieces on that board I wanted to buy. I wanted Park Place, and I wanted Boardwalk. And man, if I could just secure those two most valuable pieces of property, I was set. Then I could start building my neighborhood. And I'd load it down with green houses and load it down with red hotels. And then every time you landed on one of my parcels of property that I owed, you forked out the rent, right? And of course, the person who gets to the place where they can no longer pay rent, then, you know, they're out of the game. But there comes a time, and some of those games would last for several hours. I mean, you can waste a lot of time playing Monopoly. But there would always come a time that you would be reminded that it was just a game. It was over. So you take the green houses, you take the red hotels, you take the paper money, you put it inside the box, you close it, then you get back to real life. There is coming a day when every one of us are going to close the box. And everything that's inside that box will not matter. The only thing that will matter is what we have forwarded ahead. Jesus said it like this: Lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moth, rust can't corrupt, thieves can't break through and steal. So let me ask us in closing, what is it, what amount of our time every day is attached to eternity? How many of our treasures are attached to eternity? How many of our talents that we have are attached to eternity? Because at the end of the day, it won't matter what's in the box. What will matter is what treasure have we laid up in heaven. Would you stand, please? Heads bowed and eyes closed. No one looking around.